While Adam Smith's theory of capitalism seems somewhat antiquated nowadays, its underlying premises and ideas still dominate a large part of economic thinking. Its basic shape, therefore, continues to be a valuable object of study, and its insights as well as its shortcomings are necessary to understand our current economy. Smith saw his environment as the product of a long historical development that started with the barbarians invading West Rome and continued through feudalism with its rise of landlords and kings and the Renaissance, where the cities started becoming the centers of power. It is in this context that we have to understand the hopes Smith placed in the economic development as a liberating force. Furthermore, Smith's ethics were shaped by a desire to appeal to one's own consciousness as well as others, which he saw as the main motivator for the pursuit of wealth once material interests have been stilled. I think the latter is a central insight and still holds a lot of truth today. The societal hierarchies among the wealthiest are as strict as those at the bottom and are largely determined by the extent of the wealth, which is taken as signifying prudence, a virtue Smith held in high regard. Underneath a superficial optimism, Smith's thinking was plagued by a fear of isolation and alienation, as well as an annoyance with the need for conformity. None of these factors can be neglected when trying to understand how the economic theory of Adam Smith, that is still taught in our universities, came into existence. So now let's look at his economics. One of the central ideas of Adam Smith's theory is the division of labor. He uses the production of pins as an example, which he separates into 18 different steps and argues that it is far more efficient to assign only one step to a worker because it allows the worker to become proficient in a step and removes the time needed in order to change working benches. Smith observes then that the division of labor in an economy is proportional to the size of that economy. The bigger the economy, the more workers you have to decide that labor, divided labor amongst. But increased division of labor also necessitates increased interdependency between different sectors of the economy. Say you want to craft a sculpture, for instance. In an economy without a lot of division of labor, you might need to travel into the mountains and mine the raw materials yourself. Meanwhile, in a more divided economy, you can just buy those materials from a suitable supplier. But that also means you are dependent upon those suppliers, which are dependent upon miners. So, if you want to understand a modern economy whose labor is highly divided, a natural question becomes how people determine the price with which they buy and sell their goods, or, in other words, you need a theory of value. Smith thought about this and observed that value can mean two different things. It might refer to the utility of a thing, or it might refer to the amount of other things you can exchange for it. Those two are by no means equivalent. Smith used as an example the contrast between water, which is highly useful, in fact it is necessary to survive, but not very valuable, and diamonds, which are valuable enough but have no use at all. Which brings us to the question of, why are diamonds useless yet valuable? Smith considers the beauty, in fact, he writes, the demand for those precious stones arises altogether from their beauty. They are of no use but ornaments. Now, from a modern perspective, it is easy to find counterexamples here. For instance, the art market functions in a way so that the value of a piece of art often stands in no relation to its beauty, and a lot of art can be quite ugly, even to its buyers, and still be a good investment. Next, Smith considers scarcity, and in fact writes, cheapness is in fact the same thing with plenty. It is only on account of the plenty of water that it is so cheap as to be got for the lifting, and on account of the scarcity of diamonds, for the real use seems not yet to be discovered, that they are so dear. This statement is, in fact, true, and the reason forgery is punished so severely. You are not copying a pretty picture, you are lowering the value of an investment. But its reverse is not. So there might be very scarce stones, which nevertheless are not very valuable, because they are ugly or at least plain. However, Smith considers a third factor and decides it is the central one. The proportion between the quantities of labor necessary for acquiring different objects seems to be the only circumstance which can afford any rule for exchanging them for one another. Again, art can be used as a counterexample. The value of a work of art is often in no relation to the effort put into it. So we see that none of the factors mentioned by Smith is sufficient to capture value, at least if you want value to include the value of investments. And in fact, Smith's value theory is one of the most criticized and overhauled aspects of its work. Nevertheless, he uses it to make an important point in his theory about how price is determined. Smith distinguishes between two different kinds of prices. Natural price, which decomposes price of a product into three components. The materials needed, the rent for the working place, the wages of the workers, and an average or ordinary profit. And market price, which is determined by the law of supply and demand. Now, the important point is this. If the market price is larger than the natural price, then a lot of profit is to be made and it will attract a lot of entrepreneurs who will increase the supply, while if the market price is smaller than the natural price, factories will close down and supply will diminish. So the market price will over time converge towards the natural price. This is the so-called invisible hand. Before we continue, let us analyze some cases in which this does not hold. One example is when more supply leads to more demand. So, for instance, addictive products come to mind. Another situation in which the invisible hand fails is in the presence of monopolies or cartels, which can arbitrarily restrict the supply. Smith was highly critical of cartels and monopolies for exactly this reason. Finally, we have, once again, art, because art functions as an investment. The main reason art is valuable is because people want it to be valuable. Let us now analyze these different components of a price. Because one producer's cost of materials are another's profits, this category can be reduced to the other three, and no further analysis is necessary on the materials. To each of the others we can associate a group within the population. Rents are paid to landowners, wages are to workers, and profits are what entrepreneurs get if they are successful. Here I want to make an important side point, which is that Smith did see the profits as a reward for the risk of investment, not for the quality of leadership. Why is this important? Because if profits are a reward for the quality of leadership, it would make perfect sense for workers to want to employ an entrepreneur as a manager, who oversees and coordinates the production. Meanwhile, if profits are a reward for the risk of investment of capital, then the entrepreneur employs the workers. This is the basic difference between an autocratic and a democratic economy. Let's get into some more detail on each of these three components. Wages are, according to Smith, determined through a mechanism very similar to that of prices themselves. They depend on two factors, the size of the population and the available investment capital. If the population grows, or the investment capital shrinks, more potential workers compete over less available workplaces, and the other way around. Furthermore, if we assume that people will have children as long as they can afford to, we find that over time, wages will always tend towards the subsistence wage, the minimal amount of a worker needs to survive. Similarly, the profits tend to become as low as possible, as we saw when we analyzed how the market price tends towards the natural price. Finally, rents will go up in proportion with the population and the economy, since both need space. So now we know how each of these groups gets its money, how do they use it? Smith distinguished between two kinds of utilization. Consumption, like buying goods or furniture, and savings or investments, which are two similar things, since savings are normally invested by the bank. Furthermore, he believed that workers would mostly use their wages for consumption, since they would generally not be much above subsistence wages anyway. Landowners too would spend most of their money on consumption, since they belonged to the aristocracy, and therefore needed expensive luxury goods. So really, only the entrepreneurs would invest much at all, but those would only be in fierce competition with each other and therefore be incentivized to invest as much as they can in order to gain a competitive advantage. Now let's break down consumption and investment a bit further. First, consumption can be distinguished by whether it is into durable or perishing articles, and we can add services to the second kind, even though services are not articles. But Smith was only interested in production in the sense of real, tangible goods, so services were largely irrelevant to him. I think this is one area where his analysis seems very grained, because Western economies have increasingly abandoned the direct production of goods in favor of the supply of services. Investments can also be distinguished on the one hand by whether they are done directly by the person making the money, for instance by an expanding manufacturer, or by an intermediary like a bank. Furthermore, we can distinguish them by whether they are invested into fixed or circulating capital. Fixed capital is such that it does not perish, but also does not itself produce new capital. So, for instance, machines that accelerate the production process. Circulating capital, meanwhile, has to be continually renewed, but does bring in a return of investment, in particular workers. The important thing is that fixed capital always needs circulating capital in order to be of any use. Armed with this theoretical framework, we can now analyze the flow of capital within a given time period. Let us, say, start with the farmers paying their rents to the landowners. The landowners then will use the money thus gained to buy precious luxury goods, transferring it into the hands of the manufacturers of said goods. These will use part of the money to pay their workers. Workers will buy whatever necessities they need to survive, mainly food, sending the money back to the farmers. Finally, the producers will continue to trade amongst each other until some kind of equilibrium is achieved. But what is important here is that they gain some amount of surplus they can invest into fixed or circulating capital, hence overall growing the economy. So we see that, when all is said and done, the source of value lies in the exchange between cities and the countryside. This was true back then, it is true today, and it will be true for as long as we need food to eat and raw materials to furnish. Smith saw this and structured his distinction between classes of entrepreneurs along it. A capital may be employed in four different ways. Either, first, in procuring the root produce annually required for the use and consumption of the society, or secondly, in manufacturing and preparing the root produce for immediate use and consumption, or thirdly, in transporting either the root produce from the places where they are bound to those where they are wanted, or lastly, in dividing particular portions of either into small parcels as suit the occasional demands of those who want them. In other words, you can supply the raw materials, refine them, transport them, or trade with them. However, this does impose natural limits on the growth of an economy, namely the amount of resources it can obtain. Again, Smith saw this much more clearly than some of his successors and endeavored to describe the end result of an economy that used the maximal amount of resources it could have. The result is not pretty. In a country which had acquired the full complement of riches, which the nature of its soil and climate, and its situation with respect to other countries, allowed it to acquire, which could therefore advance no further, and which was not going backwards, both the wages of labor and the profits of stock would probably be very low. In a country fully peopled in proportion to either its territory, what its territory could maintain or its stock employ, the competition for employment would necessarily be so great as to reduce the wages of labor to what was barely sufficient to keep the number of laborers, and the country being already fully peopled, that number would never be augmented. In a country fully stocked in proportion to all the business it had to transact, as great a quantity of stock would be employed in every particular branch as the nature and extent of the trade would admit. The competition, therefore, would everywhere be as great and consequently the ordinary profit as low as possible. So, wages would be no higher than the minimum needed to survive, profits almost non-existent, and population growth stationary at best. Rents would probably be higher than ever, though. What kinds of recommendations for government did Smith derive from these conclusions? He generally argued for the pursuit of self-interest as the forming principle behind economic distribution, writing, "Every man, as long as he does not violate the laws of justice, is left perfectly free to pursue his own interest his own way, and to bring both his industry and capital into competition with those of other men, or order of men. The sovereign is completely discharged from duty in the attempting to perform which he must always be exposed to innumerable delusions, as for the former proper performance, of which no human wisdom or knowledge could ever be sufficient, the duty of superintending the industry of private people, and of directing it towards the employments most suitable to the interests of the economy." Which is the same sentiment that drove the likes of Hayek to declare any amount of government intervention as bad. Unlike Hayek, however, Smith made numerous exemptions. Most importantly, he understood that it would be necessary for the state to intervene if unforeseen circumstances threatened the economic or public health of society. Furthermore, he was deeply suspicious about any attempts of the businesses to influence government policy. The proposal of any new law or regulation which comes from the business leaders ought always to be listened to with great precaution, and ought never to be adopted till after having been long and carefully examined, not only with the most scrupulous, but with the most suspicious attention. It comes from an order of men whose interest is never exactly the same with that of the public, who have generally an interest to deceive and even to oppress the public, and who accordingly have upon many occasions both deceived and oppressed it. Here again, Smith observed quite clearly things his successors would go on to ignore. However, as explained in my first video, I think he overlooked the corrupting influence of money that would make it impossible to keep up this kind of suspicion over an extended period of time. I want to close with some remarks about Smith's works that are often overlooked. So for instance, Chomsky likes to make a point that Smith felt a great deal of skepsis with regard to the mental effects of the division of labor. In the process of division of labor, the employment of the far greater part of those who live by labor, that is the great body of people, the man whose life is spent in performing a few simple operations, of which the effects are perhaps always the same, or very nearly the same, has no occasion to exert his understanding or to exercise his invention in finding out expedients for removing difficulties which never occur. He naturally loses, therefore, the habit of such exertion, and generally becomes as stupid and ignorant as it is possible for a human creature to become. I find it is interesting to look at the influence of technology in this regard, because while our labor is more divided than ever, it has, at least in Western societies, become a little less stupefying, I think. Pins are now produced by machines, and we have to maintain and upgrade those machines, which might still not be exactly interesting, but at least better than the production itself. Of course, the statement still holds completely true for sweatshops in India. All in all, I find it more interesting how much of Smith's theory still rings true and how much does not. If we want to understand capitalism, we need to start at the beginning.